Okay, students, today's lecture is about Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction. So let me start with this. Can you see my screen? So I have not muted anybody. If somebody has a doubt, kindly ask the question, because I will not be able to see your chat. So we know that there are two laws of Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction. First law is like this. It states that whenever magnetic flux linked with a coil is changed, then an induced EMF is produced in the same coil. This induced EMF lasts as long as the flux is changing. So this is something which you have already studied in your lower classes, school classes. So it was, this first law was based on the first experiment of Maxwell. What he did, he took a coil, then he put a galvanometer and then a bar magnet. It was moved toward and away from the coil. This was supposed North Pole, this is supposed South Pole. So motion of the magnet was sometimes toward the magnet and sometimes away from the magnet. And this galvanometer, it showed deflection. Now you know that galvanometer shows deflection only when there is a flow of current. And current cannot flow without EMF. So therefore, it was indicative that in the coil, some EMF has been developed. But there is no battery or a cell in the coil. So therefore, this EMF is generated due to the flux linked with this coil. So according to Maxwell, from this experiment, he made his first law that whenever magnetic flux linked with the coil is changed, then an induced EMF is produced in the same coil. And if you stop moving this magnet toward or away from the coil, then there will be no EMF. The deflection of galvanometer will be zero. So the last line comes from this observation by the Faraday that this induced EMF lasts as long as the flux is changing. Let us now write the second law. The second law states that the magnitude of induced EMF is directly proportional to the rate of change of magnetic flux linked with coil. So actually this was based on the same experiment, but Maxwell observed that whenever the speed of moving of the magnet is large, then induced EMF was also large. This was indicated by large deflection of the galvanometer. And whenever speed of the magnet was small, then the deflection showed by the galvanometer was also small, which indicated that EMF developed is small. And if we do not move the magnet at all, then although the flux is linked with the coil, but there was no deflection of the galvanometer. It means that the basic criteria for development of for induction of the EMF, basic criteria is not magnetic flux presence. This is not the basic criteria, but the basic criteria is change of magnetic flux. Criteria is change of flux. So only flux is present does not mean that EMF will be developed. Change of flux. So I guess you should not have any doubt till this point. Ramanik Kaur Sikhu has raised hand. You can ask the question. Otherwise, I will move to the second page. Inderjeet Singh. Ramanik Kaur Sikhu, you can unmute yourself. Yes, ask the question please.
Sir, dielectrics and ampere circuit law wale topics is to baat kar lena.
Yes sir, we will do ampere circuit law after this.
Sir, and also the dielectric one.
Dielectrics are not a part of this chapter, so I will not discuss in this chapter beta. I will discuss it in materials.
Sir, Gauss law for
electric and magnetic material. Yes, sir, polarization of dielectric.
Sir, Gauss law for dielectric.
No, Gauss law for dielectric.
Yes.
Okay, she did not discuss it with you?
No, sir.
Okay, then I will discuss it with you.
Okay.
But I will discuss it in the next lecture then. Okay?
Okay, sir, and also the equation of continuity is there in the syllabus or it's in...
It has to be used only.
Okay, sir.
Its proof is only of 2 minutes. If you wish, you should study it. If you wish, then I can prove it also. But it is not in the syllabus.
Okay, sir.
We have to use it.
Okay, sir.
Simranpreet Kaur. अंकित कुमार आस्क क्वेश्चन. अंकित प्लीज आस्क क्वेश्चन.
हेलो सर, गुड मॉर्निंग सर.
गुड मॉर्निंग
सर. माय क्वेश्चन इज दैट मैक्सवेल सेकेंड इक्वेशन इज गॉस लॉ इन मैग्नेटोस्टैटिक्स और फैराडे लॉ ऑफ इलेक्ट्रोमैग्नेटिक इंडक्शन.
मैक्सवेल्स सेकेंड इक्वेशन इज
विच इज मैक्सवेल सेकेंड इक्वेशन गॉस लॉ इन मैग्नेटोस्टैटिक्स और फैराडे लॉ ऑफ इलेक्ट्रोमैग्नेटिक इंडक्शन.
It is the Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction. We will take the curl equations as first and second and divergence equations third and fourth.
Okay, sir.
Yes. Okay, I will move to the next page. Okay, according to the Faraday's second experiment, if let E is EMF produced in the coil and d phi b is a small change in magnetic flux in small time dt, then according to second law, Faraday's second law, magnitude of induced EMF is directly proportional to d phi b upon dt. So if I want to convert this proportionality into equality, then magnitude of induced EMF will be equal to some constant k into d phi b by dt. Okay, in SI system, this value k is 1, and in CGS system, the value of k is 1 by c, where c is equal to 3 into 10 raised to power 10 centimeter per second is the speed of light. In vacuum. So we will not be doing this part. We will not be doing this electromagnetism in CGS system or Gaussian system. So I will not be discussing this with you. So therefore, in SI system, our Faraday's second law will become E is equal to d phi b upon dt. This is the mathematical form of Faraday's second law. Let me call this as equation one. So next very important part here is Lenz's law. So according to Lenz's law, the induced EMF is produced in such a manner that it opposes the cause of producing it. Now, if I show you my previous page, you can see the cause of EMF is a change of flux. It is not the flux, it is the change of flux. So EMF is produced by change of flux. And if you see, this is Lenz's law. I have written here that EMF opposes the cause of producing it. So cause of producing it is means change of flux. It opposes the change of flux. Change of flux, magnetic flux, of course. So let me go to the next page. Okay, now we know that a flux can change in two ways. Flux can change in two ways. Either flux is increasing. Please remember, magnetic flux is a scalar quantity. Either magnetic flux is increasing or magnetic flux is decreasing. And you know that flux will increase when we move magnet toward coil. And flux will decrease when we move magnet away from coil. Now, therefore, we can very easily see when the flux is increasing, so EMF will try to decrease the flux. And when flux is decreasing, then EMF will try to increase the flux. And we know that derivative sign is very important. Derivative sign is very important. We will never ignore derivative sign. Because we know that positive derivatives means increasing quantities. And negative derivatives mean decreasing quantities. So we, therefore, from all these observations, we can say that this relation, which is equal to E magnitude is equal to d phi b upon dt, it will transform into this equation. I can remove the magnitude now. E will be equal to minus d phi b by dt. The negative sign comes from Lenz's law. Negative sign comes from Lenz's law. So this completes Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction. So this is the differential equation. Now let us go to the Maxwell's equation. In a differential form. So we know that E is equal to minus d phi b upon dt. We know this. We have done it just now. Please remember, there is no proof of this equation. It is an empirical relation. It is based on experiment. So it is an empirical relation. So this is based on the experiment. So we will not ask for its proof. However, from this equation, we can derive another relation, which is Maxwell's equation. So,
Gauss law for dielectrics and magnetism.
Yes?
Sir, Gauss law for dielectrics and magnetism.
Yes. These are also Maxwell's equations. Four equations are there, Maxwell's equations.
Okay, sir.
What is your query?
Sir, actually in the book, the topic is given differently in the starting, like Gauss law for dielectrics and one is Gauss law for magnetism.
Yes. These should be done differently. Gauss law of dielectrics is actually related with electricity, electrostatics. So we should do it with the Gauss law of electrostatics in vacuum. I thought that madam might have covered that also. That is why I did not discuss it. Now I started the article and after completing this article, I will go to that part.
Okay, sir, both the topics are left.
Yes. Both the topics are left. Therefore, I will keep it in mind and I will cover these.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So let us now come to this part. So what is the definition of EMF? EMF definition. EMF definition is, you might be knowing it, let me write it for you. It is the amount of work done to move a unit positive test charge unit positive test charge along a closed path by the electric field. So I would stop here for 1 minute. You read this statement, because please remember this definition of EMF. Some students might be wondering that there was one definition of EMF in school color physics. According to them, EMF is the maximum potential difference across a cell when no current is drawn from it. So most of the students know this definition of the EMF, and I am using this definition. This is actually the fundamental definition. It is the fundamental definition of EMF. This is a special case definition. Why? Because it will apply only when the circuit contains a cell. And if you see my page of the experiment, let me show it to you, previous page. You see this diagram. In this coil, you can see this is the coil. In this coil, there is no cell or no battery. So if you just remember that definition of EMF, then you will be wondering how to understand this EMF definition. So therefore, please remember, whenever there is no battery in the circuit, that definition will not be valid. So we have to go to fundamental definition, and this definition is valid even in the presence of a cell and in the absence of a cell. So kindly remember. So this definition is, you take a unit positive test charge and move it along a closed path, and the agency which is moving the charge in a closed path should be electric field. So the work should be done by the electric field. And let me now go to the next page. Now, please remember, we know that work done against electric field is given by work done against electric field from WA to B. We have done these things in plus school level. It was position of A point is, let us say, RA. Position of B point is, let us say, is RB. Then it was E vector dot DL vector, and it was minus Q0. This work done was against the electric field. Against electric field. If work done against electric field is this one, then what will be work done by the electric field? WAB. Work done by the electric field. It will be simply equal to Q0 with the positive sign RA to RB E dot DL. Okay, two participants have raised the hand. Simranpreet Kaur.
Sir.
Manav, please ask.
Sir, aa samjhayo sir fir to ek vari.
Which one? This one?
Yes, sir. Sir, against EMF electric field, sir. Kidda likhya, sir, tusi?
तो आपने प्लस टू क्लास में पोटेंशियल डिफरेंस का फार्मूला पढ़ा है?
Yes, sir.
हाँ, तो उसमें क्या होता है पोटेंशियल डिफरेंस? What is the definition of potential difference between two points?
Sir.
let me repeat it for you. You should just say okay, yes, it was correct or no. Okay.
Okay,
I guess you do not you are not able to recall it. Let me spell it for you or everybody else who does not know the potential difference. So let me tell you, potential difference between two points is defined as the work done to move a unit positive test charge against the electric field from one point to another point without acceleration. Is it correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay, this work done was therefore work, very simple formula of work done is dW, small work done is given by force into distance. But we are moving against the electric field, it will be therefore cos 180 degree. So we are moving force against the electric field. So it will be cos 180 degree. And what is the formula for force? Force is charge into electric field. So it will be, instead of dx, I would use dl. It will be q e dl and cos 180 degree is minus. And total work done from A to B will be equal to integration of dw from Ra to Rb.
Yes, sir.
That was the formula that you have studied in your lower class.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Okay. If the work done against the electric field is this, then the work done by the electric field will be just simply equal to the negative sign will change into positive sign. Now, in the definition, I have told you that work done by the electric field should be for unit positive charge. It is the work done for charge Q naught. If work done for charge Q naught is WAB, what will be the work done for unit positive charge? It will be simply equal to WAB divided by Q0 and it will become E dot DL RA to RB. And next thing, last thing, what is EMF? It is the work done from work done to move a unit positive charge along a closed path. Closed path means starting and end point is the same. So it means if you start from point A, you will eventually bring the charge again at point A. So suppose this was the coil, this was the galvanometer, and we start a unit positive charge from this point A. The charge must be moved by the electric field along this closed path. And eventually when it comes back at A, then we will say that one loop has been completed. One complete cycle has been finished. So therefore, this RA and RB will become identical and we will write it like this, E dot DL. So this is the formula for electric field. Electric field, according to the definition, you can also say, now this is the next definition of electric field, that not of electric field, it is of EMF. You can call it to be, it is equal to closed line integration of electric field, just as small as this, closed line integration of electric field. Okay, is it okay? So I'm going to the next page. So we are at the next page now. Let me now write down the definition of flux. You know that this coil is there with which flux is associated. So this was north pole of the bar magnet. This is the south pole of the bar magnet. This is the coil. And this is the surface area of the coil. So this was the flux. Flux lines are starting from north pole of the bar magnet. And obviously these are entering from the south pole into the bar magnet. My question is, let us say this surface area is S. Let us say boundary of the coil is C. C is closed path. That is the boundary of the coil. S is the area, which is in the area covered by the closed path. My question is, please answer this question very carefully, whether area S is open area or closed area. Please give me the answer to this question. One of them is correct. Manav and Shivam, they can ask question. I have not muted anybody. Swapnil.
Sir, open area?
Yes, the answer is open area. You are correct. So this is open area. So if I choose a small surface, let us say this small surface is ds. So through this, the flux linked is, let us say it is d phi. What should be the total flux linked with this coil? Please tell me. First of all, please write the, tell me the formula of d phi b. What is the flux linked with the small area of the coil? You know it from your school physics. It should be E vector dot ds vector. Is it okay? And what should be the total surface, total flux? It should be phi b. What should be that? It will be integration of this d phi b over the whole surface area. So I will write it double integration. Please remember it is open surface integration. It should be double integration of d phi b. That would become double integration of E vector dot ds vector. And now, according to Faraday's law, we have the relation E is equal to minus d phi b upon dt. So put values of both variables. We have now found the value of phi b in equation number 2. This you can see there is a value of phi b. And if I show you the previous page, then you can see there is a value of this E. This is equation number 1. So we can put the value in this equation. So E, according to this equation number 1, E is nothing but is it is equal to closed line integration of E dot dl. Then you will have minus sign, then you will have d upon dt, and then there should be open surface integration of b vector dot ds vector. So this is the integral form of Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction. What is this? It is the integral form of Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction. If you have any doubt till this point, you can ask me. Otherwise, I will shift the page. Simranpreet Kaur is asking some question. Please ask question. I have unmuted you.
Sir, after put values, please tell me.
After?
Put value, sir, jithe value put kiti tusi.
Yes, you can very easily see, beta. You can see this, dear. E is this.
Hanji. Hanji, sir.
Okay.
Hanji, hanji.
E. And this is phi b.
Hanji.
And minus d by dt is here.
Okay, sir.
Nothing is different.
Hanji, hanji, sir.
This is the integral form of Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction. Kindly make a note of this. It is integral form. And the name of the article is differential form. So I will be doing both of these. Integral form, fortunately, integral form came earlier than the differential form. This is the integral form. If you have any doubt, any here, please. Okay, 5 participants have raised hand. So please unmute yourself and ask the question. Karam Singh, ask the question, please. I have unmuted you.
Sir, what is the significance of double integration here?
Double integration means you are covering the area. Look at this. Did you attended my all previous lectures? Did you attend my all previous lectures? if we are moving on a path, if the integration is a single integration, then we will move from A to B, then B to C, then C to D, then D to A. But we are not allowed to move any point inside this rectangle. But if you are doing double integration, then we will be moving from A to B. Then not we will move from A to B, rather we can go from A to some point here. We can move to this point. We can come here. We can come here. We can come here. In general, we can move at every point within the rectangle ABCD. That will be the meaning of the two-dimensional integration. That is the surface integration. Hargunpal Singh, you asked the question. I have muted you, unmuted you.
सर ये इक्वेशन नंबर टू में सर ये बी डॉट डी एस नहीं आएगा
इक्वेशन नंबर टू में हाँ यस थैंक यू दैट इज अ मिस्टेक फ्रॉम माय साइड थैंक यू फॉर करेक्टिंग इट इज बी डॉट डी एस एवरीबॉडी एल्स शुड नोट इट प्लीज दिस इज अ करेक्शन एनी अदर क्वेश्चन सो के आई विल मूव टू द नेक्स्ट पेज So now we have this relation E dot DL over closed path is equal to minus D upon DT over open surface B dot DS. So this is equation number three now. Now let us apply Stokes theorem. I have already told you what is Stokes theorem. Let us apply Stokes theorem on left hand side of equation 3. So according to Stokes theorem, E dot DL integration over closed path C. So what was closed path C? Closed path C was the boundary of the coil that we used in Faraday's experiment. And what is the open surface S? Open surface S is the area inside the coil. So this, according to Stokes theorem, can be written equal to double integration over S del cross E dot DS. So this is Stokes theorem. So put this value. In equation number. Three. So our equation three will become del cross E dot DS double integration over S is equal to minus D upon DT double integration B dot DS. Now, please make a check. I attended your previous lecture. I joined your class earlier than my scheduled time and I noticed that your mathematics teacher was taking the class and she was teaching you differential equation, partial differential equations. So that is a good thing for you people. So please remember this is exact differentiation because it is d upon dt and this is integration over the area of the coil. Now look at this and I will also place a magnet here. Because I need a logic to do that. Now, please remember that this integration is over the area and this differentiation is with respect to time. So what we are seeing, I want to change the order. It says that we must integrate B over the area first. Then whatever answer comes, it should be differentiated with respect to T. But I want to reverse the order. I want to take D by DT inside. Please remember, any variable in the world, in this universe, always varies with time. What is the reason for this? Reason is because time does not stop, because time does not stop. Time continues to flow. So, because of this, when, of course, in physics, we can freeze the time for our problem discussion. So, what I am going to do, when I will take d by dt inside, it will become curly b by curly t. And its dot product will be this ds. Because the area of the coil is not changing with respect to time. The coil is of fixed area. So I will take the derivative of B with respect to time. And with this, I will assume that during this time, we have not changed any shape of the coil. The coil shape has not been changed. So therefore, it becomes partial derivative as soon as it goes inside it. So because of this, the exact derivative, when it will go inside the integration, it will become partial derivative. Next, let us now collect all these terms on one side. So this will become double integration del cross E, and that minus sign will become plus curly B upon curly T. And I will write a bracket here, and dot product of ds will be zero. Now, please remember, this is a definite integration. This is not indefinite integration. This is definite integration. We know that in case of definite integration, the limits of integration are known. And because we are given the coil, therefore boundary of coil is well defined. And hence the surface area of the coil is also well defined. So if you change a coil to a bigger size, or you change the coil to a smaller size. So this was the actual coil. If you change the actual coil to this one or to this one, what you are doing, in fact, you can see changing the coils from smaller to bigger or still smaller, it is in fact equivalent to changing of limits of integration. But if we see this mathematical part, the integration is equal to zero independent of the size of the coil. You can have a smaller coil, you can have a bigger coil, you can have a medium sized coil. So this integration will always be zero. So there is only one such function. There is only one for such function. Whose integration is always zero, irrespective of limits of integration. And that function is zero function. It is zero itself. Nothing else than zero satisfies this property. Therefore, if I call this as equation number four, I will say equation four is valid for all arbitrary coils since the integration is always zero. Therefore, integrand should always be zero. So I can conclude from this equation to this equation that we must have del cross E plus curly B upon curly T equals to zero, or we get to this equation, which is the conclusion of this article. It is equal to minus curly B by curly T. This is the differential form of Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction. Okay, three participants have raised hand. Prab Kira Singh, I have unmuted you. You can ask the question.
Sir, previous page karna.
Okay. So this is the previous page. See it, please. In the meantime, Vinay can ask the question. I have unmuted you.
Yes, sir. Sir, I under B. Kya hai B?
Kidi which? B stands for magnetic Ether flux induction.
Magnetic flux. Sir, you see, I under derivative. Oh, partial derivative. Kya mein ho gaya? Usse mani hai, sir.
Huh? It be please. You know from your school physics, you know that flux can be changed in how many ways? Please tell me.
Sir, appa surface change karan, matlab area change karenge ta change hoga.
Very good.
The time nal change hoga. Speed nal, sorry. Speed the area.
Very good. You can change B. You can change. Number one is you can change B. Number two, you can change A. Number three, you can change theta, because B dot ds, which is the flux, it is a B ds cos theta. So there are three variables in this equation. So either you can change B, or you can change area, or you can theta. So you have studied in your school physics that there are three ways of changing producing the induced EMF. That is by changing the magnitude of EMF, magnetic flux density, by changing the area, and by changing the orientation. So the whenever you take this step into this step, you must ensure that during this part, we are not changing the area. We are keeping the coil of fixed shape. The meaning
sir,
is
area constant.
Yes. Okay. Area is a temporarily constant, not permanently constant. Okay. Just find the derivative of B with respect to T. After that, when you will be integrating over ds, then area again becomes variable. Because ds means area is variable, na?
Sir, unko practically samjha do.
Yes.
Practically.
Okay. It is a request to you that some students continue to call me during the lecture. I will not be attending the calls during that time. Okay, suppose this is the shape of the coil at time t1. One of the students from you stretches this coil toward this side, another student stretches toward this side, and the coil changes to this one at time t2. What is this? You have changed the area.
Yes, sir.
Second part is, now this is the coil at time t1, and here it was magnet. And you can see, I have shown deliberately three flux lines passing through this coil. What happens in time t2? Coil is the same, time has changed, but you have brought this magnet closer to the coil. As a result, now the flux lines, because the magnet is now close to the coil, therefore in the previous case when the magnet was away from the coil, these flux lines, this was let us say one number, this is let us say five number, this is 2, 3, and 4. So you can see here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all are passing through this. Now this here the flux is phi 1, here the flux is phi 2, here the flux is phi 3, here the flux is phi 4. You can see flux phi 3 is greater than phi 1, even phi 4 is greater than phi 1. So I have increased the flux. In first case, how high I have increased the flux? By changing B or by changing A?
Area.
By changing A. In second case, how I have changed the flux?
By changing distance between.
By changing B, na?
Yes, sir.
Is it okay? So the condition, this curly B by curly T dot ds, it says that although you can increase the flux by changing B, you can also increase the flux by changing
area. S.
But when you are changing B, means when you are moving the magnet, then kindly do not change the shape of the magnet.
Okay.
The meaning of this is. Is it okay? Are you clear now? When you are moving the magnet, then kindly keep the coil shape same. Otherwise, both of the things can be done. There can be three persons in the experiment. Two persons are stretching the coil and third one is moving the magnet. Then we will have B and S changing simultaneously.
Yes, sir.
We should not do that. Any other question?
Sir, the reason ki appa kyon nahi karna?
We are doing that in a what we call it phased manner. Is it okay? This is just a differentiation. This is taking care of changing of B with respect to time, and this is taking care of changing of area. And the dot product here tells that the overall effect has been taken. Means we are doing both of these things, but when we are finding the overall effect of both of these things, then it should be done mathematically like this, not in the real practice. Is it okay?
Okay, sir. Sir, matlab pehle appa niche wala step karde pe, then upar wala karde pe.
Haan, now I have completed my Maxwell's equation. Ramneet Kaur Sekho, I have just 2 minutes left. All of you should mark your attendance. After that, I will stop. Just 2 minutes are left. Please ask question, Ramneet. Akal Roop.
Sir, attendance.